And now we're the first of three new plays in our chilling series, All the Dark Corners. The Desk by Andrew Redman.
Sometimes you want things. You want a thing, an object. I don't know if you've ever had that obsession. You want to own it. You want to feel it in your hands and under your control. It might be as big as a car, or as inconsequential as a pen or a piece of fancy paper, or as essential as a kitchen or a house. Whatever it is, it will make your life better. Improve it. Joggers want the latest, fastest. Trainers, motorists want the latest, fastest technology. They all want to go faster and faster. They want to briefly shine. Be ahead of the rest. But life is a lost race against the inevitable. Every object is a work of desire, and you just have to work out how to get it. And if you can't have it, if you can't get it, you feel all torn up inside, all cut up, all cut into little pieces. You know that feeling. Turns the stomach somewhere inside, hidden away for the most part. That feeling, that exquisite pain. Davis Finch picked a hacked, meagre living from penning gruesome fictions. Gruesome fictions were exciting, but life itself was dull and tedious for the most part, and the fantasy of the extreme was the safest option. If only I had that desk, he thought, I could pen some terror then. If circumstances brought him into town, he'd stop by the window and look at that desk and imagine himself sitting at it, writing and writing faster and faster and being successful. For words are knives and sentences poison lances. I'd see him. I'd see Finch looking in the window, dreaming about owning this desk. I'd sit in the cafe across the road and watch him. It was a bureau, Victorian, roll-top mahogany, little drawers, beautifully made, polished. Not my kind of thing, but for Finch, it was that transformational object that would soothe his disaffection with this humdrum world and make him a success. But he could never have foreseen the consequences of bringing that desk into his house, into his life, because he had not reckoned on the twisted narrative that life throws up. So you see, he was perfect.
Yeah, but you know I want to write a novel.
And?
Well, how can I do that when I'm on the treadmill knocking out hacked TV scripts?
Because I want to have a baby, that's why.
But do you think that's an either-or situation or a both-and situation?
The latter.
I'm not sure they fit together.
Bach had lots of children and managed to write one or two good tunes.
Bach?
Well, you know what I mean. The one doesn't exclude the other. We need the money.
Babies cry.
Only if they need something, and not all the time. Sometimes they giggle and laugh and smile.
I guess so. If I give you a baby, can I get that desk?
A baby is not a thing. A baby is a being. A glorious little bundle of living, breathing joy. A desk is a remodeled tree.
Of course, but...
There is nothing to barter here. Silly thing. You'll be a great dad. And you'll spin a great yarn in your novel, too.
Dad. A book about nappies.
Why not, Dad?
Dad? No.
Stop it.
You know I hate being tickled. I'm up murder, horror and suspense.
No, you're not. Kiss me.
It's very elegant.
What is?
The desk. Shall I turn out the light?
No, leave it on. Oh.
So, what's the verdict?
Well, you have, how shall I put it, wandered off the brief.
I've made some creative improvements to the plot, for sure, but...
Davis, you're writing a script for a continuous drama. The plot's been agreed by the script editor. You've agreed to the task. All you have to do is join the dots, not rewrite the plot or reinvent the characters or add new ones. This gig's not about authorship. It's not the Davis Finch show.
But the storyline was...
What?
Dull and predictable.
He who pays the piper calls the tune. It's a job. You just need to play the game.
Oh, sorry, I didn't realise it was a game.
Oh, why do you always do this?
I think I've got something to say here.
They don't like it.
Right, Well, then I'll change it.
Well, there's no time to change it.
Let me talk to him. There's been a misunderstanding. I'll explain.
Too late.
I'll join the dots. I'll play the game.
Do I have to spell it out?
Spell what out?
You're fired, Davis.
Fired?
Yes. Sorry, but there it is.
I put 3 months of my life into that episode. 3 months wading through the unbelievable script conferences where we examined and discussed ludicrous events. I sweated blood making the improbable probable, so come on. Give me a break.
This is nothing to do with me.
Idiots, the lot of them. Wouldn't know a decent script if it hit them in the face. I knew they didn't like me.
Why do you always do this? It's not about you.
They can't do this. I need the money.
Well, you should have done what they asked.
I did.
Quite frankly, Davis, the fact of the matter is...
Yes?
You're unreliable, impetuous and egotistical.
Well, thanks very much.
You had a brilliant success when you were 27, and since then you have not lived up to expectations. This is business.
Thanks for being so candid.
Well, you need to get real. You make a product, we market the product, we sell the product, we farm out your skills. We make money out of words and ideas. It's the entertainment industry, not the Starving Artist Benevolent Fund.
I needed that second half episode fee. I'm broke.
Well, give me something else to sell.
A novel.
Really?
Yes.
Pitch it to me.
Now?
Well, why not?
It's embryonic.
Embryonic?
Yes.
Well, when you pop out of the hole, send me the first 5 chapters.
It's about a washed-up, half-pissed... No, well-pissed and well-pissed-off TV writer who gets bumped off yet another job and goes to drown his sorrows in a cheap pub where he meets a complete stranger. They get lashed to a mast as the sirens sing and he ends up in some dodgy council house, drug-fueled house party where he takes too many class A's and he wakes up in the morning in a bath with a girl. Except the girl is stone cold and the bath is full of blood and the door is wide open and the house is deserted. He does a runner and when he gets home he writes up the experience and the words fly off his pen like a man possessed because he's writing from experience. Spurred on by his rush of narcissistic excess, he becomes more and more obsessed by journalising his sadistic adventures and serialising them in glossy magazines and reading about his exploits in the pages of the press, and he gets off on the media frenzy.
Ooh, sounds good.
It sounds ludicrous.
There's a market for that stuff. Don't knock it.
So you want me to live a life of crime in order to meet the appetites of the readership?
Don't be stupid. It's fiction.
Is it?
Desperate people are the easiest to rescue. They are eternally grateful at first, trying to escape from what they have constructed. He had this image of a roll of chicken wire, and wrapped in the middle of the roll was Finch. Imagine that. He could see, but he couldn't get out. Imagine a wall of gabions and inside each a finch. He could only go where the delivery van was going, only be part of the wall someone else was constructing. The desperate are no longer in charge and Finch was desperate. He just needed a helping hand. And I was happy to extend mine.
With an exemplary police service record spanning 25 years, Detective Inspector George Harrison has been involved in some of the biggest murder trials of the past 2 decades. He's written 11 highly acclaimed factual accounts of his work for the police service, and we're delighted to have him here today to talk about his latest work, The Ones That Got Away, after this.
Hiya.
Hi, how did it go?
Great.
I told you it would be fine. You were so worried about it.
Yeah, I know, but they loved it.
No more rewrites.
Nope.
So it's payday then?
Let's go shopping.
When the money's in the bank and not before, and we need to pay Daddy's loan back. You on your way home?
I just fancy a stroll around town. Just need a little inspiration.
Okay, well, walk around and get inspired, and then come home.
I'll be home for tea.
You mean dinner?
Yes. Forgot you were posh.
Tea is for tea time, obviously.
Obviously.
Don't buy anything. Strictly window shopping for you. And when we do get the money, I want
something
a dishwasher.
Crass intro, I know, but...
I couldn't resist, because I have in the studio with me George Harrison. And no, it's not the Beatles legend, but the police detective whose new book is coming out this week. So, George, The Ones That Got Away. Sorry about the Beatles, gang. No doubt you've heard that 1 or 2 times in your career.
Yes, usually I get Where's Ringo?
So, tell us about your book, then.
Well, I'm due to retire soon. Police retire early. and I wanted to re-examine all the information I could in the hope that one day these crimes would be solved and the criminals brought to justice.
Because, in a sense, what this book is really a confession of failure.
Well, I suppose it is.
And at the centre of the book is what you think was a series of linked killings.
Yes, the modus operandi, everything points to a serial killer, or killers.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I've come to ask about the desk.
Yeah, nice thing, that. Victorian.
Where did it come from?
You want provenance?
Just looked like it belonged somewhere.
I got it from a dealer. Don't know where it comes from. Antique shops are like bus terminals. Stuff comes in and stuff goes out. A terminus.
Yes, well, if you say so.
Destinations and departures.
Very good. I've always wanted a roll-top desk like this. A bureau.
Yeah, they are popular. What line are you in?
Not that popular. I've been watching that one for weeks. Writer, I write.
Oh, what kind of things do you write?
Do I have to answer that?
No, just curious.
Cops and robbers. True crime. Well, true-ish. Made-up crime based, if somewhat obliquely, on real events. Isn't everything. Although we always say any relationship to persons real or fictional is entirely coincidental. Trips off the tongue. So it's all a blur, actually.
Really?
Really.
A desk like this should be an inspiration, then.
Well, we all need that.
Take a seat.
Ta.
How does it feel? Great.
Did you ever have that feeling of complete knowing? Exquisite clarity, exquisite vision. That inner sense that, regardless of life's vicissitudes, everything will turn out well. A prayer answered. As soon as he sat down at the desk, he was in a different place. Transported to another world, and sadly for Finch, but happily for me, it was not a world of his making. It was a world of someone else's making, mine. The desk filled his head with pictures and filled his heart with vanity. It was electric, powerful, omnipotent even, and Finch was fluent in his resentment. He knew exactly what he had to do. The desk gave him the power. He'd pen a vicious narrative, he'd slaughter them all. That's what he thought.
How much is it?
500.
500?
Well, it all depends on how you value your aspirations. And just think where aspiration and inspiration could take you.
When can you deliver?
But I wanted to bring home to the reader the reality of the situation. So much of what we hear or think about crime is based on fantasy and fiction. Forensic reality is much more gripping.
Well, it certainly is. So this murder dubbed The Runner was the first of these linked murders.
Yes, that's right. Oh, I'm sorry. I should have switched it off.
No worries. Are your services required?
No. Sorry about that.
So, about The Runner.
In 1988, I was called to a crime scene in North Manchester. A group of children, well, teenagers actually, boys, were on a cross-country run from a local school. And one or two of the older boys had discovered a shortcut through a copse of wildly overgrown rhododendron trees.
Oh, what a gruesome discovery that must have been for them.
Yes, it was. Unfortunately for us, the shortcut was well known to the rest of the year too. And so the crime scene had become so contaminated that any attempt to collect forensics was virtually impossible.
And it's still unsolved after all this time. What motivates these people?
Well, I'm not a psychologist. And it's all too easy to say sex or money or jealousy or revenge or honour or perverse enjoyment.
Enjoyment?
Of course. The uncomfortable fact is that some psychopaths get a kick out of murder. The killer creates his own fiction as fact.
And on that chilling note, here are some more chilling notes. Thanks for the interview, George, and all the best with the book.
Thank you.
Better check your messages.
Yeah, sorry about that.
You have one new message.
Anything important?
Nice interview, George.
No.
Still dining out on those old ones? Well, I have some news. I have a new chapter for you.
What's that?
A desk.
I can see that.
I bought it to write on.
So it seems.
I decided that I need a desk. We discussed it.
You decided. We did not discuss.
Yes, we did. I said, what I need is a desk, so I bought this desk. And on this desk, I'm going to write something.
Is the money in the bank yet?
What?
The money from the script, is it in the bank?
Yeah, any day now.
Why not just say, no, Rachel, the money's not in the bank?
I'll speak to Valerie, give her a nudge. You know what she's like?
Why do you lie to me?
What?
You told me that they thought it was great. What's going on? I'm worried about you.
They did. There's nothing to worry about. I'm fine.
They didn't.
What are you talking about?
They hated it. You let me believe that the money was going to come in.
It is. It will.
Not according to your agent.
Valerie?
She called. She let it slip.
I have another week to tidy things up.
You haven't got another week. They sacked you.
Look, love.
Don't look, love, me. You lied to me. And then you went out looking for inspiration, feeling all forlorn and melancholy, and bought a piece of vanity. And you know, no, we're skint. You've blown it.
Rachel.
Take it back. It's ugly. You're ugly. Liars are ugly.
No.
Take it back or I'll take an axe to it. And how is that going to help you?
Don't be ridiculous.
Me? Ridiculous? Me? We are scraping the barrel. We are strapped for cash. We have debts and a mortgage. I can't borrow any more money from my parents to bail us, rather you, out. And to top off all that, you lied to me.
It's under control. This desk...
It's not. It's all out of control. You are out of control. How much did you pay for it?
It was a bargain.
How much?
I knocked him down.
How much?
It was more to deliver it than buy it.
How much did you spend of our money on your desk?
5
Pence?
100
Are you mad? Are you completely mad?
It's an investment.
It isn't. You have a laptop where you can work anywhere.
Yes, I know.
You do not need a desk. You do not need a £500 desk. You need a table to put the laptop on, and that is all. I'm going out, and when I come back, I want you to have made...
No, not now. It'll be too late to collect it. It'll have to be after the weekend. You'll have to live with it till Monday, at least.
You stupid, stupid fiction of a man!
Oh! Damn! Ow! Oh, I've broken it. No. It's a draw. An envelope. Manuscript. Today is the day I go killing. What the hell is this?
Inspiration drops from heaven. Plop. The manuscript in the drawer and the hands all tied together. I tied them all together. And in the middle of all the fury circling around him, he sat down at the desk and he read from first to last. A parched man at the fountain. It was brilliant and terrible. The events, the murders, the detail. A gift. The warm hand of literary friendship. A school of artists inspiring each other to great things.
Today is the day that I go killing. I've been thinking about it for a while now, and this morning I decided that today was the day to go and do something and stop thinking about it, because thinking is a kind of mental illness. All the people I know who are thinkers are also mad. They're caught up in their own thoughts to such an extent that they are incapable of doing anything, and I could see myself becoming one of them, so I decided to do something about it. So I decided to go killing instead of thinking about going killing, and I'm going to write down everything. Every move, thought and feeling, every experience will be journalized. Come with me into the horror.
He couldn't put it down. He held it in his sweating hands. It was everything he was looking for. Well, not everything, because it was just the beginning of a book, the first 5 chapters, but it was enough. He took a pen and wrote his name on it. Then he took an envelope and wrote his agent's address on it and posted it to her.
Harrison. Is that you? Is that you? If it's you, just tell me where you are and I'll come over.
I'm ready.
Ready for what? Shit.
Sold.
Sold?
It's brilliant. They love it. I love it. How did you do it? Surely you didn't write that in 3 days.
I did. Stream of consciousness. Just poured out of me.
Marvellous.
So, how much?
Ooh, dark horse. Publication serialisation. No pun intended. Got a bidding war going on. Then, who knows? Film rights on Mars. Bingo, jackpot! Brilliant. Finch, you are brilliant. I could kiss you, but I'm not going to, ever.
You sold it just on those five chapters.
That's how things are done now. It's a tease, starts off a juicy bidding war.
So, how much?
Oh, I reckon six figures, up front.
Wow!
Yeah, and that's without the translation rights. Move over, PD and David Peace. It's a completely new voice for you. And the detail, gruesome, they love it.
They love it?
I don't know how you did it. Did you sell your soul to the devil? Did you stand at the crossroads and make a pact?
I think I did, yes. It dropped into my lap.
Well, you're on a roll now, Finch, so get stuck in.
Sorry?
Well, you've got to deliver the rest of the book, darling. Get up early, get busy, don't lose the muse.
Yes, the muse. I better get back to my desk and work on the rest.
You do that. Chain yourself to the desk.
Hello?
Did they like it?
Who is this?
Did they like it?
Yes, they liked it.
I knew they would.
Is it real?
I used to work in an art gallery. I used to sit on the chair and watch the people come and go. They only had two questions. Is it real? And how much is it worth? So now it's my turn. How much is it worth?
A lot of money.
I'll come knocking on payday.
I need the rest of it. Where's the rest of the manuscript?
You already have it.
What do you mean?
Rachel! Rachel! Has he been here?
Yes. Another envelope.
What's going on?
Have you been in all day?
You know I haven't.
Have you been in my desk?
How would I do that?
Did you lock the door?
Of course. What's going on, Davis?
Nothing. I'm just having a moment.
You're acting really weird. What happened with your agent?
Everything's fine. It's all going ahead.
Yeah? What's in the envelope?
The book. The book I've been working on.
Can I read it?
Later, when I've redrafted. How long were you out for?
Not long. Your phone's ringing.
This morning? What time?
About 10. Nip to the shops. Answer your phone.
Hello?
Just be nice to her. We don't have long with each other. Just be nice.
Who is this?
Live for now, Finch.
Who is this?
Is there something I should know?
No. Nothing. Cold caller.
On? Why are you changing the locks? Why are you locking doors?
It needed to be done. Should have been done when we first moved in. Who knows how many sets of keys are floating around for an old house like this? Doesn't that bother you? Could be keys for this house languishing in the pockets of lunatics. I'm keeping us safe. I need time to work and I need you to feel safe. Do you feel safe? Because I don't. I need space to work. I need to feel safe to work. I need to work without interruption.
Davis, you need a break, love.
It's the work. It'll be over soon. Soon as I've delivered the book, I can rest. And then we'll be quits in. Because it will have my name on it. My name!
When a man is maintaining two versions of the truth, which will he choose and how will he know that his choice is true? And what of the truth he has rejected? What if the truth he has rejected is actually the truth and the truth he has chosen could not be further from it? So it is for Finch. If he pursues his fiction, he loses his mind. If he comes clean, he loses his reputation. So he delivers the rest of the book, my book, and it gets published to great acclaim. And the money starts rolling in great waves. He moves house, better area, but mainly to escape. But there is no escape, because he has ignored his capacity for evil. The desk delivers, he collects. But Judgment Day is coming. The knock on the door, the knock on the door, the knock on the door will surely come.
The rain fell in sharp, straight lines of a Japanese woodcut into the face of the running girl. It blasted her young skin into a glowing redness, a permanent erotic flush. Well, that's how I saw it, as I waited and watched as she climbed through the hill in smooth strides towards me, as I pushed her to the ground in a violent embrace and set to work.
Thank you, Davis. And Davis will be signing books at the desk over there.
Oh, God. There's piles of them.
Yes, piles of them. And he signed them. He signed them all. He put his name on each one, book after book after book, with his name on, with his signature on. The deal was complete.
Hello? Who's this?
You know very well.
I've changed my number. How did you get it?
You've also moved, but I know exactly where you live. Very nice, too.
Look.
You read my work well. Quite the actor. Quite the professional liar.
Let's finish this, eh? Let's do the deal and part company.
But the sequel, Finch. The sequel.
Sequel.
Hello?
Could I speak to Valerie Stevens, please?
Speaking.
I understand you represent Davis Finch. Is that correct?
That's correct. How can I help you?
I need to speak to him.
In what regard?
I have some questions I'd like to ask him.
And you are?
Oh, sorry, I'm Detective Inspector Harrison.
Is there a problem?
Oh, no, just a few questions. Look, could you arrange a meeting or ask him to contact me?
Has he done something wrong?
His book. There are some details I'd like to talk to him about.
Is he in trouble?
I don't know. I need to talk to him. I went to his reading last night. I need to speak with him. Can you arrange it?
Of course. When?
Today. I need to see him today.
I've read your book, Mr. Finch.
Would you like me to sign it?
How did you come by it?
What do you mean? Sat at my desk and it revealed itself to me.
Really?
Yeah, I sat down and I wrote as it occurred to me.
Did you? In the book, you detail...
Not me.
But what do you mean?
The character reveals. I just write it down.
Uh-huh. He details, the character, the murder of a young woman in 1988. The woman was found mutilated and dismembered in a public park. The murder's well documented. You may have heard of it. The press dubbed it The Runner.
Is that so?
In 1988, a woman was found in a park in the condition which you... the character describes in the book.
Any similarity between events or persons in my book are entirely coincidental.
Yes, in fiction, that's the case. I write myself. I'm more interested in facts, not fiction. One day, perhaps. Even so, I am aware of the wording. You knew that, didn't you?
What, that you were a writer?
Would you like to take the call?
If it's important, they're right.
Take the call.
No, it won't be important. There we go.
So, tell me about one of the murders in your book. The one in the park.
People get murdered in public parks. It's common knowledge.
Come on, cut the crap.
What crap? I write a book and you question me about a murder which happened 20 years ago.
Yes, and you lived locally.
Along with thousands of others, hardly evidence.
Your descriptions of the murder, the position of the body, the weapons used, the time, the date, the efforts of the police, which are brutally mocked, are journalistic accounts of sadistic killings, not works of fiction. Works of fact. My line of work, not yours.
Are you suggesting...
What?
I didn't kill anyone.
Let's look at another murder in your book. It's remarkably similar to one that occurred in 1992. Here, page 82. A boating lake was drained and the workers discovered a bag, and in the bag were body parts. I'll say that again, because it doesn't seem to have sunk into your head just what it is we are dealing with here. Body parts, Mr. Finch. Pieces of what was once a delightfully happy young woman. You must have read about the case.
I may have done.
Really? When the case was made public, certain details were withheld.
Of course.
So how did you know them?
Know what?
The details.
I didn't. I don't. I just made them up.
You must research.
Of course.
You were 15 in 1988, the year of the Runner murder.
Yes.
And you were born around here, went to school around here.
Yes.
Then you went to Sussex University. And funnily enough, your halls of residence were very close to the boating lake where the body parts were found. And you were there in 1992.
I've been doing your homework.
Technology makes that easy, and I have staff.
Look, Mr. Harrison, it's all very nice, and I'd be happy to help, but I'm not your man.
I've got things to do, so if you don't mind...
The location of the weapons in both murders was never released to the public. Where they were disposed. Yet you have them in your book.
It can only be a coincidence.
Indeed. Did you choose that murder for your fiction, or did it choose you?
That's a bizarre question. I've never murdered anyone in my life. I don't intend to, either. Look, Detective, you are barking up the wrong tree. I'm delighted that my work has served as an inspiration for your inquiry.
Aren't you going to answer that?
I thought I'd switched it off.
Take the call. I can wait. It must be important if they rang twice.
Have we finished?
Just who is ringing you, Mr. Finch?
Is that any of your business?
Shall I tell you what I think, Mr. Finch? I think you're in something deep. Something that has got out of hand. Something evil. And I'd like to believe that you had nothing to do with that evil, but at the moment, everything points to you.
But I'm a writer. I make things up. I am not who you are looking for.
Well, I think you can lead me to him. I think you're in communication with him, and I think he will kill again. In fact, I think he will kill you.
Hi, Rachel.
Did you have a good heart-to-heart? Did you tell him everything?
Where's Rachel?
Oh, she's fine. Lovely-looking woman.
Have you got Rachel? If you touch her, you lunatic!
What did you say?
Please, don't hurt her.
I've told you I knew where you lived. You need to clean up your desk. It's a tip. Papers everywhere. It's a wonder you can work.
Look, I'll do anything. Where are you?
All in good time. But I have been to your splendid new house. I was just passing, so I thought I'd drop by and collect something. Your lovely wife.
You bastard!
And in return, I've left something for you. Some instructions.
Oh, my God.
The car speeds through the night. The blue light flashes, but the siren doesn't sing to warn the sailors from the rocks. Finch is eating his lips, consuming himself with his own horrors and wishing at the same time, and to his eternal disgust, that he could capture this moment forever. Harrison drives with all the desperate calm of a professional.
Who is he, Finch?
I don't know.
If you're lying to me...
Oh, God. He's got Rachel.
Why you, Finch?
Because I was stupid. Ambitious. I took a gamble, sent it in as my own. I passed it off as my own. I don't know what he wants. I really don't know why he chose me, but I just want it to end.
No need to panic. It'll be over soon. We'll get him and the nightmare will be over. Trust me. Now sit tight. I just need to check in, make sure everything's ready. Harrison here. We're 5 minutes away. I presume everything is in order. Suspect may still be in the house. Keep silent on this one. No idle chat on the radio. I'll give the go.
Oh, that's sick. I thought there'd be more people involved.
In the movies, there is.
I suppose the fiction is how we assume things are going to be.
Nice observation.
I wish it wasn't. Will there be uniformed officers at the house?
No. They'll be around, but out of sight. Best keep this low profile. Don't want to freak the neighbours.
Hello? Hello, Rachel?
What are you looking for? There's nobody here.
How do you know?
Back door's open. Assistant desk?
Yes.
Where's the drawer? You like doing that, don't you?
It's the only way it opens.
Look for the instructions.
Nothing. It's empty. Oh, no, no. Hold on. Here it is. Here, you read it.
Hold it up for me. I don't want to get my prints on it.
Don't you have gloves?
You watch too much television.
What about my fingerprints?
Doesn't apply. It's addressed to you. Between the church and the river in the wood, I have the final chapter in the place where it all began. Full circle. Harrison knows the place. A devastating conclusion and the only possible end. The usual formalities apply. Call no one. Bring nothing. This is the payback, Finch. You made a deal. I am now collecting.
He says you know it. How would you?
He's taunting me. He's been taunting me for years. Yes, I know exactly where it is. Fir Tree Woods.
If he touches Rachel...
He won't. I'll make sure the place is surrounded. You go down ahead of me. I'll give you a head start. I'll be watching you. I'm right behind you.
Are the team in place?
Yes, everything is going to plan, believe me.
But if we know he's here, then why not just go in and get him?
He'll escape. You need to meet him.
So I'm the bait.
You want to find Rachel, don't you?
A helicopter would be good. I usually complain about police helicopters, but tonight I would really find the roar of an engine a comfort.
It's on standby. It'll be here within minutes of my call. Look, I'll call now. Harrison here. Get the chopper on standby and make sure the whole team's on alert. I'm sending him in. No sirens, no radio chat until I give the go. Feel better now?
No.
Just go.
Shouldn't I be wearing a wire or something?
Told you you've been watching too much telly. Just go. It'll be over in minutes. As soon as you flush him out, we'll be there.
Breathe. Breathe. It'll be over soon.
Halfway through the journey of my life, I woke to find myself in a dark wood. How I came to be there, I do not know, for I had fallen from the straight path. And this savage forest in the strangling night renews my every fear. Or something like that.
Are you the guy that's been...
Yeah.
Where is she?
Nearby.
What do you want?
I want nothing, it's you. You wanted all this, the success, the fame, you stole it.
You gave it to me!
You could have refused. Did it never bother you that you were making money out of real events?
I didn't know!
Oh, come on!
Where's Rachel? You can't get away, the place is crawling with coppers!
Well, not exactly crawling. I told you before, she's nearby.
Take me to her! Release her, take me! Rachel! Rachel! You'll never get out, I'll kill you!
I don't know about that. And don't worry about your lovely wife. She's... well.
Why? Why did you do this?
You were perfect.
What? You're caught, mate. You're caught. Do you hear me? Harrison! Harrison! I've got him! Harrison's here. He's got coppers surrounding the woods and a helicopter. You won't get away.
Quiet helicopter, is it? I mean, very quiet. In fact, so quiet as to be non-existent.
It's on its way!
No, it's not.
Harrison, thank God. Get him! Get him, then we can find Rachel!
Evening, George.
Hello, Morris.
What the...
It was fun, this one. Required a lot of plotting.
It's easier to write about what you know. I like facts.
What the hell's going on?
Do you want to do the honours or will I?
Not yet. I'd like to watch, record it all.
Everything fits rather nicely.
You, Finch, are technically connected to all the murders. We've been looking for someone like you for years.
Oh, my God. I've been set up.
You could say that.
Are you going to kill me? You're going to kill me? Oh, God.
Stop whining.
So it was both of you? You're both involved?
Not initially, but you've got to look after family.
Family?
George is my big brother, aren't you, George?
Yes.
Your brother?
I've always looked out for him.
Even when I've been bad?
Morris found you. Watched you for months. Did his homework. Don't move. I will shoot.
You're a policeman. I trusted you.
Do the speech, George. Do the speech.
Shut up. It's not a magnum.
Do it anyway. I love this game, George.
Fiction in the making.
You've got to write about what you know.
Rachel!
Under the twisted canopy of the night, my victim went running. Calling out, a man possessed. Whipped by the brambles, he runs into the wood, runs for his life, runs to escape his life, and George and me follow. Hound him deeper and deeper, taunt him with wolf calls and the thrill of the terror. We herd him closer to where we want him, his fate, his beloved. We exhaust him till his burning lungs collapse and he falls to earth, his face full of loam.
Good effort, Finch. Any final words?
Let me see Rachel. Let Rachel go. Let me stand. Let me stand!
Let him stand, Morris. But no moves. I've got a gun.
Rachel! Where is Rachel?
Can't you see her? She's behind you.
My God. My God. Rachel! You bastards!
I hate it when they throw up. Inspired by Goya, this one. Do you like art, Finch? No doubt you prefer the pastoral. I fancy trying my hand at the visceral.
That's what they did to the apostates and the traitors. Draped them on a tree.
But what's it, George?
She was innocent! She was innocent!
She was also pregnant.
No. My dear God. No!
The sodium clouds shone, and the whole scene turned Halloween orange as they wrestled each other under the cataract of night. I knew I had to end it, although I was a reluctant Caesar and these my entertaining gladiators. Finch had nothing left. Rachel watched from her savage, mute vantage point. Finch was left with nothing. Nothing but his body, nothing to hand, no weapon, but his very self. Finch imagined himself a bullet and had launched his body at Morris, knocking him to the ground. I did nothing. Simply stood back and watched. The writer and the killer wrapped themselves around each other as desperate as love itself in the violent dark of the wood, in the stench of the loam and the leaf mould, until each was indistinguishable from each. Finch had gambled that I would not shoot my brother. Morris was shouting now, "Get him off me! Get him off me!" But I let justice run its course. I watched. And then, to end their misery rather than my enjoyment, a gunshot. And one more. The wind in the trees, a dog in the night, the exquisite silence, the taste of the wet air on my lips and lungs, and life itself with death, the only ending. We all go back to nothing, and nature's slow creep consumes us all.
And it is a pleasure to welcome back retired Detective Inspector George Harrison.
Thanks for having me on again.
But this time you've written a piece of fiction.
Well, it's fiction inspired by fact. It's connected with the terrible events of last year.
George Harrison.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let me just turn this off.
Oh, isn't that policeman's book? I read about it in the paper on Sunday.
That's right, yes. It seems to have captured the public's imagination.
I'd like to write a bestseller one day.
Wouldn't we all?
I was wondering about this desk.
Yes, yeah, a nice piece.
Do you know anything about it?
No, nothing. Things come and things go.
A writer's desk. A desk with a story to tell, I bet.
And what would you write?
Oh, I don't know. Something about real life.
Well, a desk like that can serve as an inspiration.
Indeed.
Take a seat. Try it out. Get a feel for it.
When can you deliver?
In The Desk, Harrison was played by Tim McInnerny, Finch by Graham Hawley, and Rachel by Karen West. Morris was played by Greg Wood, Valerie by Melissa Jane Sinden, and the shopkeeper by Russell Richardson. The Desk was written by Andrew Redman and produced in Manchester by Gary Brown.